So I'm a talker with my hands, so I'm always used to doing this and being mic'd up, or I got a loud enough mouth. I told Ryan, I said, I don't need it. He said, well, we need it for the recording. So I'll try to, I may get. So it's good to see everybody tonight. And, you know, the Bible tells me, do not forsake assembly of ourselves.
Yes,
and like he was getting at a minute ago, I like, sometimes I need, not just like, but I need the fellowship of my brothers and sisters. You know, in the spirit of the Lord, I can always have the Lord with me, but there's just something about fellowshipping with those, you know, and to serve our Lord and to praise Him and honor Him and glorify Him. I can do that every day, and I try to all the time, but there's just something about church. There's something that, you know, I there's times I have to miss. I don't like it. But me and Larry was talking about, I own my own business. And sometimes when somebody calls and their furnace is broken, it's a Sunday. I ain't got a choice. I've got to go. If it's emergency, if it's cold. If it's not, I try to put it off. But there's just some things that sometimes a Wednesday evening, they call, I've got to go. But I try not to miss as much as I can. But I sit last night and got in my word and tried to think, you know, Lord, what would you have me to bring tomorrow? And I always want the Lord to be in it. If He's not, it does no good. We all just might as well just sit here and just keep singing. You know, but there's no substitute for the Word of God. That's the way I feel. Always been that way. Always will be that way. You know, there's been services. I've been blessed. And, you know, I come from a background of, you know, where there's liberty, there's freedom. Where there's liberty, the Spirit's there. You know, and that's how I believe. And I've seen many of services. And I'd like to see more of that sometimes, but I've seen some services, some of us hopefully we can see that, but you know, the singing take off and the Spirit just come in and they just keep singing and praising, and we never had any preaching. You know, we just had some good old gospel singing and the Spirit of God, and we had church without the Word of God. You know, and that has happened, but I don't think it should happen all the time. But I do believe the Word of God is important. And without the preached Word of God, I wouldn't be where I'm at today. Yes. It pricked my heart. I thank Him for it.
Yes.
And I get thinking about the day He saved me. It makes me emotional. And the day I quit doing that, I think I'm going to be a little worried. But I start thinking about the day He pulled me out of that miry pit.
Yes.
Larry, it's something special to me. And I hope it is to you, all of you that know Him. But I sit there last night at the table and I thought, Lord, what do I bring? You know, there's so much of the Bible and there's so many amazing things to say and so many things but I just don't want to talk about something amazing. I want the Spirit of the Lord to be in it. And then as I started reading and studying and believing what God gave me, I thought, Lord, now this is a good Sunday morning service when the house is packed and there's maybe some there that are wavering. And I said, but usually Wednesday and Sunday nights is the core of the church. You know, the steady, the believers that follow Him. And I thought, Lord, what are you doing here? And I fought with it today and thought, you know, and I learned a long time ago, if God says, preach it, preach it. Maybe there's someone here that needs it. I know me and my wife talked about the same stuff last night. And I do worry at times. The Bible tells me not to. I'm supposed to trust in the Lord, but I still worry. I have a family. Me and my wife have 7 children, for those that don't know.
Hallelujah.
We're blessed. And I don't know if we're just blessed or if it's we're just something half wrong with us. I don't know yet. But people keep saying, you guys done yet? Like I heard a guy the other day, he was talking, we just had a new baby. People clapped. He said, we just had the fourth one yet. And the place got quiet. He said, see, after about 4, they treat you like you're Amish. So I guess that happens with me, But I just want to thank the Lord for tonight and thank Him for being here. And I won't try to keep you long. I know we try to keep to time and everybody has to work. Or if you don't, they just got things to do. But I started last night praying about it. And I said I wanted to go to Matthew chapter 7. Chapter 6, I'm sorry. I want to start with verse 20. It's and I'm going to go to the end of the chapter. It's quite a read, and And for those that want to stand, you can. But Larry, I always want this to be something that God wants to bring. And I truly try to listen to the Lord and the voice of the Lord. And here in chapter 6 and verse 20, it says, "But lay up yourself treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, where thieves do not break through or steal. For where your treasures is, there will your heart be also. The light of the body is the eye, and therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. But if thy eye be evil, thy whole body shall be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in thee be in darkness, how great is that darkness?" We're in chapter 6, verse 24, Matthew. "No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. Ye cannot serve God and mammon. Therefore I say unto you, take no thought, therefore, your life, what ye shall eat, or what ye shall drink, not yet for your body, what ye shall put on. It is not the life more than meat, and the meat body for raiment? Behold, the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns. Yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they? Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit unto the stature? And why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these." That's powerful. We'll get to that. "Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall ye not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Wherefore take no thought, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or with what shall we be clothed? For after all these things do Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have no need, you have need of all things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for tomorrow, for tomorrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is evil thereof." You can be seated. You know, I sit today even at my lunch break at work, and I'm trying to kind of get used to this. I just started this new job and the casting plan, and I've always been kind of laxed at work. I've always had an environment where I do heating and cooling, I do electrical work and plumbing, and I've always been in the field where I kind of just work at my own pace. And well, here now I got 12-minute break, an 18-minute break, and a 12-minute break. I'm used to having hour lunches, and that's when I study my word and get him. Well, it's hard to do that. So I've got to try to set time aside in the evenings, and that's when family time. But I sit there today, and I still struggled and thought, you know, Lord, I just, you know, and what do I speak on tonight? What do I preach on tonight? And he just kept saying, what I gave you. What I gave you. I gave it to you for a reason. And so hopefully somebody here tonight, or maybe all of us, I know I could use this, and I'll try to. I only got about 9 pages here, so I think we'll be okay. But I named it "Do Not Worry." How many in here don't worry? You don't worry at all? Man, I want to be in your world. Now my wife will tell you, I am one that's pretty much a lot of times says, you know what, God will take care of it. God will take care of it. My wife is one that she looks at the worst of things, and I bless her heart, so I don't mean to be bad about it, but she looks at the worst of it and just hopes for the best. But she just always thinks that, you know, if it can happen, it's going to happen to us. And you know what, and sometimes that does happen. But God teaches that all things work to the good of those. Doesn't it? All things. It doesn't mean some things. All things. And then it says we glory in tribulation also in Romans 5. Why? Why should we glory in tribulation also? What's it say? It says, Because it brings patience. And patience what? Hope. Experience. And experience what? Hope. Every time something has happened in my life, no matter how bad it is, since I've been serving the Lord, it's all worked out. It's all worked out. It may not have worked out the way I want it to work out, but it's all worked out. And the reason the experience and we glory in tribulation also, and at the end it brings hope, because God got me through the last trial and tribulation I had, so it gives me hope I'm going to get through the next one. Praise the Lord. Amen. So that is what I want to talk about tonight. This right here, I've heard this passage here preached 1,000 different ways. But today I want us to look at being Christ-minded. It says here in verse 20, it says, lay up treasures for yourself. How do we do that? How do we lay up treasures for ourselves? No. But how do we lay up treasures for ourselves? By helping one another. By doing good things. By serving the Lord. Doing the things that God has us to do. And if my brother just needs prayer and lift it up, then I do it. If God tells me to go out and give my last $5, then I do it. If I just want to say hi to somebody and smile, and maybe I don't even realize it, but it makes their day. But maybe sometimes I don't even want to smile. You ever had those days? I do sometimes. I got to be honest. I do sometimes. I'm just having a bad day. But I do it anyway. Why? Because I love the Lord and He loves me. Amen. I ain't got no choice. There's a smile in me that just can't be hidden sometimes. And that's the treasures I'm talking about. That's the treasures this is talking about. I can lay up all the treasures in the world here, but when I die, we all will do it. We all will be horizontal one day, and I believe I want to be in a church house. But I'm not taking anything with me. Not a thing. So laying up those treasures aren't going to do me any good. But here it says, lay up treasures for yourself. Verse 22 through 24, I said here, it says, the light of the body is the eye, and therefore thy eye be single, the whole body shall be light of the eye. What do you think that means? Seeing one vision. Eye on the Lord. Keeping your eye on the Lord. If you got one eye and you're one-minded, one-sided, there's no room for anything else. There's no room for anything else. And that's what I need in my life. That's what we all need to do in our life. It's easy in this world to get distracted. I'm not trying to say it's an easy thing to just walk a straight path and keep it on Jesus. But it's pretty daggone good. You know, but there are things in this world that keep us distracted, that tries to keep us distracted. He's called the enemy. That's his job, but I don't give him credit. I know some people as Christians, I love them to death still in there. Every time I turn around, boy, the devil's on me. Boy, the devil just this, the devil just that. Do you think maybe that's just life? You know, that's just life, and sometimes we give that old bird too much credit. I believe so. And we keep giving him that, and once we speak those things, I believe that too. You speak things in existence, you watch what you talk about. You're going to get it. But here it says, the light of the body is therefore the eye that is single. Thy whole body shall be full of light. But if thy eye be evil, thy whole body shall be full of darkness. And therefore the light that is it be the darkness, how great is that darkness? I put here, it says, the light of the body is the eye. If the eye be single, what does that mean? Keep your eyes on the Lord. Keep kingdom-minded. You know, I have bad days, but it doesn't mean that I ain't kingdom-minded. And that's where the devil wants to get you. He wants to get you down here and just stop thinking about, oh, how poor me. Pity me. Why does all these bills pile up? How come everybody can pay their bills but me? How come everything is just so hard, just me? That's what the devil wants you to think. You know, and that's what he does sometimes. But I just have to look at him and say, you know what? It ain't that bad. There's somebody got it worse than me. I always have to keep that mind. That somebody has it worse than me. I'm not saying I got it bad and I'm struggling, I can't pay my bills. I'm just saying this is what the devil does to us. You know, this is real life. We got to grow up. We become adults. And boy, we just all wish we couldn't wait to grow up, could we? Now I just wish I was a kid sometimes and you can not have a worry in the world. But I do. And that's just how it is. And the enemy wants us to think about, oh, how rough it is. You know, Larry's had a rough time with his brother. But one thing Larry said back there, you know, Mike, a lot of people just like you didn't think he'd ever be saved. But you know what? He's with the Lord. Amen. He's with the Lord. Amen. He's going to miss him. And we miss those loved ones. But it's good to be able to say, but they're with the Lord.
Amen.
You know. But we can have a hard time with it, and that's okay. But we can remember what they were and who they are.
Yes.
And where they're at. And that's the great thing about it. It says, and I put here, but if we lay up our treasures in heaven instead of earth, where will other physical necessities come from? We ask ourselves that sometimes, huh? Where am I going to get my food? Where am I going to get my clothes? Oh, no, oh, no, oh, no. You know anybody like that? Yeah. But that's when you look at them and say, you know what? But the Lord takes care of me. And He's going to take care of you. I've been there so many times with people that they just don't have any hope, and the devil's defeated them, and maybe they're a new Christian, and maybe they just haven't had the walk that we've had. And God needs us. That's who we are here on earth. We're God's people. And we're here to help those that do struggle. And I have had many, and I know you have too, had many people come to me and say, but what am I supposed to do? Where's my next meal coming from for my children? What's this and what's that? And that's when you say, that's when you need the Lord. And that's when you take them and you say, you've got to believe this Bible. Front and back, there's no ands, ifs, or buts. There's no middle ground. You believe it from the front to the back. And when you get that settled in your heart, you'll find out that there's a lot of truths in here that will help you. And you take them to where Jesus fed the 5,000. You know, it used to seem so supernatural to me. How's that possible? But once I start serving the Lord, I found out how possible it was. That God can truly feed anybody with nothing. And those are the people you talk to. Those are the ones you tell them, say, because when I tell you what, if I sit here and tell you that my shoes are black, whether you can see them or not, and I tell you my shoes are black, and that's just it, they're black shoes, and I know for a fact they're black, you're going to believe me. The same way when I talk about God. I don't talk about God with question. When I'm witnessing about the Lord and people's asking and they're worried in their life and the things, I tell them with facts, and I tell them with just powerful and in the Spirit of God, and just, and the Lord works through me, but I don't ever question. I don't say, well, I think God's in my life, or I think God works for me, and I think He helps me from time to time. No, we know He helps us. We know He's there in our life. I know my shoes are black, just the same as I know my God is real. Just the same as I know God can take care of you. Just the same as I know God can feed your children. That's where you take Him to this verse.
Amen.
This chapter, this word. It says here, life and body are definitely more important than food and clothing. Amen? There's a lot of times in my life where I've thought about material things before I was a Christian and after I was a Christian. That I think about material things. I want nice things for my family. I want nice things for my children and things. But there was a time where that was all I was consumed with. Now I'm not consumed with that anymore, Larry. I'm not consumed with that stuff anymore. And my wife has probably heard it too many times. The Lord will take care of it. The Lord will take care of it. And she doesn't see me go, the Lord will take care of it. No, she sees me say, the Lord will take care of it.
Yes.
Plain and simple. My shoes are black. The Lord will take care of it. But here it says life. It says, who provides life, our lives and bodies? It's God. God provides life. God provides for me. God feeds me. God breathes, helps me breathe. God helps me buy my black shoes. God helps me, well, not to get a haircut. My wife got mad. I cut my own. But God helped me get the clippers to do it. But God gives me life. Nothing else. No money in the world can give me what God has truly given me. There's no clothing, there's no rings, there's no enough watches, there's no, none of that gives me life. Sometimes, my wife bought me a beautiful watch for Christmas. Beautiful watch. I've never had a nice watch in my life. I've always been the guy that, I buy a $10 Walmart watch, I'm okay with it. Well, for my birthday, my wife said, I don't know what to get you. And she got me a nice watch. Well, I've had it, August is my birthday. I haven't even been able to wear it. It's a nice, expensive watch. And the thing's been broke since August. I sent it in. They charged me to fix it. I paid almost $100 to fix it. Got it back just a few weeks ago. And it still doesn't keep time. That watch doesn't feed me. That watch is nothing to me. No offense, honey. I love that watch. It's pretty. But that watch doesn't supply my needs. If somebody says, boy, that's a beautiful watch, I'll say thank you, and it makes me feel good, but that watch doesn't do anything for me. These clothes I wear doesn't do anything for me. The cars I drive doesn't do anything for me. That stuff used to do things for me. It doesn't anymore. God gives me life. God gives me food. God gives me this watch. God provided for me and my wife for her to get me that watch. Do you see what I'm saying? When someone comes to you and says, I'm so worried. I've had people just broken and distressed. People has taken their own life because they didn't see any hope in anything else. Those are the ones I want to reach out to and say, I need to take you to Matthew 6. I need to teach you something. I need you to understand how amazing my God is. And therefore it says, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat, or what you shall drink, nor for your body, or what you shall put on. Let's go down here. It says, but verse 26, behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor do they gather into barns, but yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much more better than they? Amen. And I was telling my wife last night, we was talking about this, and I think sometimes as Christians, we give a wrong message and we take that out of text, though. Sometimes I think we tell people this stuff and they think, boy, I ain't got to do nothing. God's just going to take care of it all. The birds still had to gather. The birds still had to search through that grass for that seed. The birds still had to go out and get his food. Even though God provided, he still had to go out and get it. And I think sometimes we give the wrong message. Oh, God provides for the birds. He's just going to take care of us and we can just lay around and do nothing. God's going to be all right and life's going to be okay and it's great. No, I got to go to work every day. I got to go out and find my food. God supplies it. God makes my body able. God gets me up in the mornings. God puts my feet on the ground. God gives me breath. God gives me everything, but I still have to get up and breathe, and have the will to go to work, and provide for my family, and get a paycheck, and the same way with the birds. Yeah, God does love them, and he does feed them and provide for them, but they still got to gather. They still got to gather all winter long and try to find food. God provides it for them, but they still got to go get it. And that's where we need to understand. People can say, well, I've been praying for months and months, and my life's still horrible. I still can't find a job. You have to try. And you know what? I found out the more and more I try in my life to strive one-sided, serving the Lord, the more things come to me. The more I find more things, the more I find quite a bit of food. I just got to be honest. But God provides for me. But I do have to do things myself. I do have to work. I do have to go out in the highways and the byways. But God provides. And that's the key to it all, that God provides. But as long as I stay kingdom-minded, as long as I serve him, as long as I stay in his will, he will take care of me. And that's the key. When we're talking to people and they're in desperation and you have to tell them the truth. That's part of it. The Bible's the truth, front to back. Some of it I didn't always like. It speaks to me always, that sometimes isn't how I want it spoken to me. But that's the same way here it says, but they don't sow not, nor neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, but yet your heavenly Father feed them. People, it just doesn't mean you can lay around and God's just going to take care of you. But sometimes that's the message we need to give people. But as long as you're trying, I've heard people so many times say, boy, I just try to serve the Lord, I can't. Or I've tried to do this and God just isn't helping. I say, how much have you done for God? Now, I'm not trying to say that you have to do something for God to get something. But I'm just saying, when my children, I got a 2-year-old that pushes me sometimes. I got to be honest. He just sometimes, I feel that now that I'm older, my patients are a lot thinner than they used to be with my other kids when I was 20. But through life, we've raised many children. And a lot of us here have. Now, you could probably think in your mind, Larry and many others, if you have more than one child, there's probably one that was probably a lot better than the other one. I love them all. But there's one you just always, it's quiet, where is he at? And then there's another one, it's quiet, oh, she must be in her room reading a book. I had one daughter that was always quiet, and I never worried because she always was doing something good. She was never a problem, never a hassle. But when he's quiet, we go look, see what he's doing. And I'm getting to that point because I want to make this point. There's some of my children would come to me when they were little and say, Daddy, can I have a sucker? Well, yeah. Well, Daddy, can I have this? No, because you've been bad all day. And that's the same way God works with me. I don't know how he works with you. But when I'm serving him and doing what I need to be doing and being in his will and the center of it and taking care of the things I need to take care of and being kingdom-minded, I found that everywhere I step, it's paved with gold. God takes care of me. But if I step out of his will and I start kicking and throwing fits, and I find that God doesn't give me as much as he used to. And I found that in my walk. And maybe that's how we need to explain things to people too. You know, but kind of sidetracked there. But says here in verse 27, which of you by taking thought can add one cubit unto the stature? And why take ye thought of raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow, how they toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you, even in Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of these. And I wrote here, I said, I put here important to read. I want to read this here. I put, he who displayed great goodness as to form the body. Who is that? God. He who displayed great goodness as to form the body and breath into it, breathe of life into me, will surely follow up on the blessings and confirm the smaller favor of providing for us and that life preserved. Did you catch that? The greatness of God that breathed life in me. I was made in his image. You was made in his image. God is good. He is not going to let me go without. God is not going to let me starve to death. God is not going to let me go homeless. God is not going to let me have to walk to work every day. God is not, do I have to keep going? I serve an amazing God. He will provide for me. And I like here where it talks about Solomon. Who knows about Solomon? He was a pretty wise guy, wasn't he? He kind of come back on him a little bit. But he asked God to give him wisdom, did he not? And God blessed him with mighty wisdom. You think God can't do the same for us? Yes, he can. God has given me great wisdom. If you would talk to my parents, and just how my daddy, I love him. He's one of my best friends. When things are exciting, I don't care if I bowl a good game. I'm a bowler. So I don't care if I bowl a good game, but I'm texting my dad, letting him know. You know, if something happens good in my life, I call my dad because he's one of my closest friends. My wife's my best friend. Did I get points there? But my wife's my best friend. But me and my dad are close. But there's a time in my life that my dad looked at me and said, "Son, I love you, but I do not like you." Whose fault was that? It wasn't my dad's. But if you could talk to my parents and just sit down with them for about 17 hours to get through a little bit of my life, what I did to them and put them through, my parents will say, "God has given my son a lot of wisdom, because I did a lot of stupid things, and God has blessed me." And that's why when I sit down with people, they say, "Boy, I've done too much. God can't forgive me. Or my life is so horrible, God can't fix it. Or I'm this, or I'm that," or they're worried to death about this, or worried about that. And I just said, "You got a little while, let me talk to you. Let me take you over here to Matthew chapter 6. And let me tell you a little bit about me and what God did for me. And let me tell you a little bit about the Word of God and what it's going to do for you." Solomon was a wise man, but God's given me much wisdom. God has done so much for me that I never can give back. I try to give back to God. I can never give enough. I can never get enough. Never, never give enough. He's given me so much, I'll be in debt for eternity. If He never gives me another thing, I still can never repay it. And that's what people need to hear. That's what people that don't have any hope need to hear. And I have so many people that come to me and say, "Boy, I'm saved and I'm a Christian, but I don't see hope in their life." And I just pray that God speak to them. Because if they serve the same God I serve, there'll be hope. There'll be hope. So I just start praying, "Lord, just show them. I can't see who they are in here and where they're destined to go. But sometimes I know by their speech, or I know by their walk." You know your own kind. And that's when you don't want to offend them, but I just pray, "Lord, show them who you truly are. Show them who you truly are, and show them that they truly need to know you." There's two ways to know God. There's, "Oh, I know the Lord." And then there's, "I know the Lord." I said the exact same thing, but did you catch it?
Yes.
"Oh, I know the Lord." Or, "I know the Lord. My shoes are black. I know the Lord. He takes care of me. He does for me. He's my everything. He's my morning. He's my night. He's my evening. He's my breakfast. He's my dinner. He's my provider. He's my everything. I know the Lord." And that's what people need to see. People need to see that confidence that I have. Because why? Let's go back to Romans chapter 5. I glory in tribulations also. Why? Because it brings patience. It brings experience. And it brings hope. That's what we're to do. We're to bring hope to those that are worried. We're to bring hope to those that don't have hope. That's what God put me here to do. God told me, go to Matthew chapter 6. Go to Romans 5. Go to Philippians 4:13. Tell him you can do all things through Christ. Who what? Strengthens me. I do nothing without him. I can do nothing without him. But I do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And that's what they need to hear. I put here, look at the birds of the air. Look at the birds of the air. God provides for them. Did he create them in his image? No. Did he create the geese and the ducks and the muskrat and all the creatures that crawl? But he provides for them. Not just the birds. He provides for all of them. So why would he not provide for us? He created us in his image. We are the greatest thing to him. We are the greatest of any living thing on this earth. We mean more to him than any of it. So how is he not going to take care of you? How is he not going to take care of us? That's what people need to hear. That's what they need to believe, but they have to believe it. Why? How? Because you believe it. Now, I've been around some dangerous stuff working. And if I have been trained by different people and different things, go, well, I think this will kind of work if you do it like this. That doesn't make me feel very confident. Especially me. I work a lot of electricity. I work with molten metal. I climb around in attics. I do this. I do some dangerous stuff. Somebody tells me, says, well, you do it like this, I think you'll be okay. That doesn't make me feel very confident. But if somebody says, you do it like this, you'll be all right. It's a little different. Same way when you're witnessing to somebody. Know your facts. Be solid in the word. Know who you're talking about. Know who you serve. And know who you're going to let them know who they can serve. That's how it works. I put here, how are we more valuable than birds? Look at the lilies. Look at how they grow. Without any toil on their part whatsoever, nor any care bestowed on them by any human, yet their glory surpasses Solomon. What does this mean? Through God's care, occurring at a favorable time involving divine intervention. Through God's care. That lily is here for a purpose. It's here for a purpose to do something for God. No matter what it's for, it has a purpose. And that's the same way we are. That lily with no care, no nothing at all. No, I'm talking about wildflowers. They grow and bloom and they have a purpose and they do that purpose. Why? Because God. Now, if God cares enough about that lily to grow and nobody needs to take care of it, how is he not going to take care of you? How are you not going to grow? I'm almost done. Put here, if God is able to clothe the grass of the field, is he not willing and able to do so for you? Use that. Is created to life, life eternal with him. God says, take no thought what we shall eat, because he is saying he is going to provide. That's why it says that. Don't think about what you're going to eat or how you're going to be clothed. That's what they need to hear. Because God that I serve, that if you come to know and serve, will provide for you. That's why he tells me not to worry about what I'm going to eat. I don't worry too much about what I'm going to eat. I know what I'm going to eat. I know God's going to take care of me. And sometimes I eat too much. But I know that I know that I know that God is going to provide. Sometimes things have been tight sometimes in finances. I don't know anybody here that probably never had that time in their life. I think we've all been there. And there's been many times where we've been blessed to be able to give and give and give some more. Why? Because God provided. And God provided for me to be able to help provide for somebody else. But there's been times in my life where it has been a struggle. But I know I can say, it's okay. God will take care of this somehow. I mean, so many stories that I hear about how God has provided for those that thought there was no way. There was no way, God. There's no way that anything could ever come good of this. Or I could ever get this. And God's people come together. And I've seen people come to know the Lord more in shock of how God had worked and God's people had worked. There's been so many times where I've known people that needed things and God's loving people came together to help them. And that's what it's talking about. That God, we need to provide. Help me, Lord, here. I need to get this out. But they need to know that they're made in his image. God didn't create them to go to hell. God didn't create them to worry. God didn't create them to not have hope. That God created them to live with him for eternity. And when they don't have hope, you're going to be the hope they need. That's all there is to it. And I And I challenge you today that go to him and say, God, help me be that hope. Well, that's a lot to ask. Oh, I don't want to be that. I'm too busy already. But God, help me be that hope. Help, let people see hope. Let people see you and me, where they want something. I've had so many times people come to me because I have been on the other side of the tracks. I'm not proud of what I've done, but I'm proud of who God has made me today. God has done a mighty work in me. I can take no credit for none of it. But God has done a mighty work in me. And I've had so many people come to me. I had one guy. I've known him all my life. We ran the streets together. We did a lot of horrible things together. But one day I was working at Golden Corral. And that's a whole nother story in my testimony. I waited tables for $2.13 an hour and paid off a house in 5 years. I was so blessed. It was amazing. But I'm blessed and happy where I'm at, and I'm waiting tables, carrying dirty dishes, cleaning up after people's slobber and spit, and it's just not a good job. But I loved it because God gave it to me. And I was a pretty new Christian. I couldn't find a job, and I just got out of prison, and nobody, McDonald's wouldn't even hire me. And I had three little children, and I've already been neglecting and living this horrible life. And now that I was a Christian, I wanted to do the right thing, and I couldn't. After a year of searching, they were going to throw me back in jail for child support. But God provided. And my parents ate at Golden Crow all the time, and my parents went one day and was talking to the guy that worked there, the manager, and said, my son has made some mistakes. My dad said, he told him, actually, my son's made a whole lot of mistakes. But he's a good man now. And he just needs a break. And the guy looked at him and said, I don't care where he's been. I just care where he's going. Tell him to come talk to me. And I'm telling you that. I'm going to make it quick. And I'm going to close. God put me there for a reason. I was blessed to have that job. Some people say, boy, I would hate to have that job. I love to have that job. At that time, that was the greatest job in the world because God provided. And I didn't go to work every day going, oh, I hate this job. Because if I go to work every day saying I hate this job, I'm going to hate this job. But I was in love with this job because I knew God gave it to me. God answered my prayers. And God ministered to so many people through me in that 10 years at Golden Corral. It was amazing. But I remember the greatest thing. It was 10 o'clock at night. I'm a crybaby. You'll learn that. It was 10 o'clock at night. And I was wiping the table down, cleaning my section, Gary closed. And there's this guy that I grew up with. His name's Mike Welch. He spent most of his life in prison. All of our kid, growing up as a kid, everything. And he was just one of these times, he happened to be out a few little bits. If you knew him, he was always in trouble. And he said, Mike, he said, you got a minute? I said, yeah. I said, what do you need? And he said, I want what you got. It wasn't one of them dummy moments going, what do you mean? I knew God showed up. And I had a small window. I had a small window to witness to him. And I only had probably a few minutes to tell him how great my God is. And I sat down and I said, Mike, let me tell you. He said, my life's horrible. You know how my life's been. I just want what you got. And I said, I can't give it to you, but let me tell you who can. I said, and I can't give you that. I said, but if I could explain to you, and you could feel this much of what I feel every day, you'd pray with me right now. He said, I want it. And we prayed right there in the restaurant. Hallelujah. We had prayer. I don't know if he received the Lord or not. He never said one way or the other. But I know that day when he walked out, he knew that I served a great God. He knew that Mike Zell was that different person. He knew that he wanted what I had because, was it because of me? It was because of G-O-D. To this day, I guarantee you that man knows that God is real. Whether he's serving him or not, I don't know. I haven't seen him in a lot of years. But I tell you what, it's powerful when people see hope in God through you. Yes. I'm not bragging on me at all.
No.
I hope you don't take it that way. But it feels good to know that my shoes are black and you believe me and that you believe me. And I think it's great when my God is real and they believe me. That's what we need to get out, church. I'm going to close, but I challenge you this year to, we talked about this and Brad talked about this, about the church and ministering to somebody and just reaching out to one person and try to take them in and mentor them and show them somebody that's struggling or somebody that doesn't have any hope and just be their friend. They'll see God in you. This church house could be completely full and we'd have to build another one. I guarantee you, if we all took that commitment, it could happen. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father God, we thank you, Lord, for today. Lord, we thank you for the spirit that I feel here tonight, Lord. And it says where two or three gather, you're there. Lord, I love it when I come to assemble with a body of believers. Lord, but I just thank you, Lord, and I ask you, Lord, that this word go out in our hearts tonight. And maybe we keep it with us, just not today, not tomorrow, not next week, but forever. As we walk and live on this earth, that we take this message, Lord, and we live it. And we go out there and we ask them that don't have hope if they want it. And that we give them a message, Lord, that they will believe in you. Lord, I want them to see you in me. And Lord, and that's what we want. That's what it's about. Lord, but I ask you, Father, to be with us. Touch our hearts, Lord. Give us that mindset to want to serve and just one-eyed. Lord, I don't want two eyes. I don't want to be able to see to the left and to the right. Lord, I want to be focused on you. And that's where we need to be. When we're kingdom-minded and we're one-eyed and we're looking straight forward and only for you and your glory and what you can give us and what you can give those and what you can do for those and what you can do in the world, and that's when things are going to happen. Lord, I thank you for who you are. Lord, I thank you who you always will be, that you never change. Lord, I thank you. We glorify you and we honor you in all that we do. In Jesus' name, we all say, amen.